Hi, my name's Ryan Champion, and welcome to a brand new series called Getting Behind the Wheel, where we take a closer look at some of the most iconic cars. Now, if we're talking iconic cars, there isn't a car that's more iconic than the Porsche 911. An incredible car, first introduced as actually the Porsche 901, but Peugeot took exception to that, and it was renamed the 911. Introduced in 1964, there's now over 1 million 911s on the road. Some of the most legendary 911s have been those used in motorsport, an incredibly successful car in racing and rallying. So let's take a closer look at some of those. Now, the 911 is incredibly well known in racing, but it's also had a very successful rallying career. It won the Monte Carlo Rally 3 times back to back in the late 60s and early 70s. It also took victory in 1978 with a car and body kit very similar to the one we're going to look at. And in the 80s, the new Pro Drive team built the famous Rothmans 911s, the SCRSs, and they were actually painted on this very site by Tuttles. So, an incredible history in rallying of the 911, and in recent years, the East African Safari Rally has been dominated by the 911. So here, in the new motorsport workshop of what's fast becoming the home of the 911 in the UK, Tuttle Porsche, we're surrounded by some incredible race and rally cars with some amazing history, but we're going to look at one car in particular today. We're going to look at the winner of the 2023 East African Safari Rally, driven by Eugenio Amos. So let's go behind the wheel of this particular Porsche 911. So as you said, Africa, and in this case Kenya, is incredibly tough on a rally car. So what's different about this to any other rally car? Well, firstly, look at the front of the car. You've got strengthening on the front. You've actually got a ball bar, if you like, on the front of the car to protect the car from potential animal strikes in the wild, because in Kenya, you're covering something like 4,000 kilometers. Obviously, there's a lot of wild animals, and you do need to protect the car. You got the splash guards here. In 2023, the rally was very, very wet, and to reduce the amount of water coming over the windscreen of the car, we've got these splash guards you see here. We've got a shackle there prepared for the Toro. Again, a lot of mud holes on the rally. You do need to put the Toro up on the car. You do need assistance sometimes to get out of those thick mud holes. And that's ready to put the Toro up on, which we'll look at in a little while. Coming back down the side of the car, you see quite a high ride height. The terrain is incredibly rough, and the stages are really very rough and rocky in places. You have to have the ride height to deal with that. So higher than we would normally see a rally car for the Safari Rally. Coming back a little bit more, we have these special little mirrors with high intensity lights in them. Again, it comes back to animals. The rally covers a massive distance. As we've already said, lots of wild animals. The high intensity lights, they see very, very quickly, and hopefully that scares the animals off. Very important part of a car for the East African Safari Classic Rally is a roof vent. There's no air conditioning in these cars. The only thing that keeps the driver and co-driver cool in 30 degree plus temperatures, it's the fresh air being forced in by the roof vent you see here. Linked to that, we'll see the glass is all reflective, again just to try and keep some of that heat out of the car and keep the cockpit inside as cool as possible, but even then you regularly see temperatures of 40 plus degrees inside the car. This car is literally just as it finished the rally, so as we said, it won in 2023. Rear wheel arch is missing here, but this car is in fantastic condition compared to some of the cars that finished the event. We'll talk about suspension in a little while, but that's one of the key secrets of this car working on the rally is very special dampers underneath the car. So incredible ride on those rough stages. We'll talk about that in a little while. Strength and suspension as well to deal with the impacts that it takes in Africa. 3 litre air-cooled engine. So just under 300 horsepower on carburettors. Again, we see protection on the back of the car. That bar gets used if we need to tow the car out backwards. So again, a lot of attention to detail around the car, especially for this rally. Open up the car and come inside. We're used to seeing a roll cage in all competition vehicles. These cars have an incredible amount of welding for the rough terrain that they deal with. It's an 8-day rally, so the cars have to withstand an incredible amount of punishment. So lots of seam welding, lots of strengthening, as well as the roll cage in terms of safety should there be an accident on the event. Little things inside the car to make the rally run a little smoother. Things like two intercoms. We've got intercoms inside the car to speak driver and co-driver, obviously, because of the noise levels inside the car. Again, you're covering long distances, so there's a spare one. We look down, and even on the floor here, we can see there's two throttle cables. They're mechanical throttles. This is an air-cooled 911, dating back to around about 1980. So mechanical throttle, again, if you break a throttle cable in the middle of Kenya, then you would be stuck. So two throttle cables to prevent that. We've got camel backs inside the car. Again, just a little bit of comfort for driver and co-driver. Fuses, you see, easily accessible on the dashboard there. So again, if there's any issue, if you blow a fuse there, they're very, very simple to change and very quick to change. Two fuel pumps, again, just for that safety in case there's a failure of one of the pumps. One thing that often gets asked on these cars is why is there a bit of mud flap material on the door handle? And again, attention to detail, simply to stop the mud getting inside the door handle. And actually, in the hot temperatures in Africa, that mud solidifies and then you can't get the door open. So a little touch there, just to, again, make using the car that bit easier. So let's have a look under the bonnet. We've not got an engine because it's a 911. But a bit of car prepared for the East African Safari Classic Rally. A few unique things. Firstly, huge fuel tank. You can see you get well over 100 litres of fuel, long sections without refueling. Two spare wheels, quite an important point. Obviously, punctures are an issue when you're on rough terrain, so you've got two tyres in there. This one has a cut in the middle of it for muddy conditions. You also see a significant tow rope in there. We touched on the tow rope before. That proves very, very useful if you do get stuck in the mud. A key point on an air-cooled 911 is the one thing cooling the car is the fan. And should the fan belt break, that could potentially stop your rally there and then. So always carried is a spare fan belt, and the driver and co-driver practice changing the fan belt so that in the middle of Africa, if they need to change a fan belt, they can, and then they can continue on the rally. All right, so let's take a look at the engine. So a 3-litre air-cooled flat six, obviously the Porsche 911 known for its flat six. The original car would have been fuel injected from this period, but just out of reliability for a long distance rally, like the Safari Rally, this runs on carburettors. And as we said, the all important fan belt and the fan that cools the engine. There is no water cooling, there's only air, so that is vitally important in the heat of Africa. So now with the car jacked up, you can see the amount of suspension travel that the car actually has to deal with the rough African roads. So suspension really is key to traveling quickly over the rough ground. Two things, firstly for performance and secondly for strength and reliability, and that amount of suspension travel really helps this car. Now, it's a classic event. The cars have to be in their period specification, pre-1985, but the one free area is the dampers on the car. So they're more modern dampers, XTC dampers, similar to what's used on a World Championship car. So let's get behind the wheel and take a look. So now we're behind the wheel, you can see the size of the actual damper. Now you can see there's no spring. This is a period 911, so torsion bar suspension, so the spring is done by the torsion bar, so you just see the damper here. And as we said, a real key to going quickly on rough terrain, so three-way adjustable. So you have the high-speed compression, low-speed compression, and rebound as well, all in adjustment in the XTC damper. And getting those settings right is a real art to going fast on bumpy roads. The brakes themselves, competition cars, used to seeing huge brakes. Any rally car that's on gravel, the stopping distances aren't that quick on gravel, obviously on a loose surface, so it means you can run a smaller disc. You've got a 15-inch wheel, so you've got the higher profile tyres to make them more puncture resistant. Actually a smaller disc, but still with a four-piston caliper, so you've got very good stopping power, but obviously you can't stop as quickly as you could on tarmac. Something vitally important under the car, again on rough terrain, you've got the under protection, so you've got the guard that runs under the front of the car, and we'll also have a look at the guard at the back that protects the engine. Strengthened suspension arms as well. As we said, very, very rough terrain, and the car has to be built to withstand that. Now at the rear here, we can see the two piston rear brake calipers, and we can also see the rear suspension layout, and testament to the strength of the 911 Imperial. While some of the suspension arms are strengthened, it's fundamentally the standard layout. And same with the drive shafts. You've got a proper drive shaft, what you can see coming out of the gearbox there. There is a spare drive shaft carried inside the car, which we'll take a look at, that the crew could change on the rally. But they are a very, very strong component on the car. The linings on the inside of the wheel arch, they help to stop the mud getting clogged in the wheel arches, because actually on a muddy rally you can accumulate somewhere in the region of 50 kilograms of mud stuck to the car. Now, as we've already said, this car is literally just as it finished the East African Safari Rally, just as it crossed the finish line, literally just shipped back last week. And we see here the very tyres it finished on, and they're a key component on any car, whether it's on tarmac or on a loose surface. You see the nature of a gravel rally, you have quite a rough pattern, very key to deal with the gravel. On this particular car for Safari, it's the same size tyre on the front and rear. Sometimes on a rear wheel drive car, you use a bigger tyre on the back with more surface area, but on the Safari Rally, they're actually limited on the number of tyres. So they use the same on the front and rear, then they can be swapped over. Now, the actual tyre itself, as well as having to deal with rough terrain, rocks, gravel, it also has to deal with speeds of up to 130 miles an hour. So it really is a key component on the car. So we've got some genuine African mud here. On the specially made braid wheel, the wheels have to be incredibly strong. You can see the tyre is strengthened in the sidewall. The wheels have to be strong as well to deal with those rocks and the big impacts that can take place. Taking a look behind the wheel. Now we're just getting this channel started, so if you can like and subscribe, maybe tell us even what cars you'd like to see on the channel, and we'll bring some more exciting content to you very soon.